Let's welcome Amit Nigam, Head of Equity from Peerless Mutual Fund. Amit, what's your take on this market? Is the valuation, is the numbers which are coming out, be it GDP numbers or auto sales numbers, are you comfortable investing or are you comfortable being 100% invested in this market?
So hi, good afternoon. So our markets have rallied significantly, and that is to be expensive. But when we are investing in equities, we are actually looking at the medium to long term, on which India seems to be a very exciting opportunity. The low print of GDP to which you referred, and also the disappointment in earnings which have happened in the first quarter, we can largely attribute it to the implementation of GST, which we believe was a one-off event, was well known to people, to investors, where in the month of June, a lot of industrial activity actually slowed down. And when we slice and dice the GDP data, that's where we find the degrowth or the slowdown to have happened. Now, having said that, because of this poor numbers of first quarter, the entire year numbers actually get downgraded, and that's what we have seen. So the FY18 EPS numbers for the Nifty companies, let's say, would have seen some kind of a write down for this year, which essentially means that the markets today, the way we are looking at it, tends to be slightly more expensive than what it was earlier. Now, if we are looking at our Indian equity markets from the medium to long term, I think the opportunities which are offered in terms of infrastructure growth, in terms of consumption, they are immense. We are 1.3 billion people who are consuming, and consuming at a far more rapid pace than we were, let's say, a decade ago, given the fact we are younger and we are earning. So with such great fundamentals in place, I think Indian equity markets would be a great place to be invested in for the medium to long term. Short term valuation challenges is something that we have to navigate through. We have to carefully select our companies, our businesses, but I think we will be in a good place a few years down the line.
But Amit, the short term challenges related to valuation can be addressed by just consolidation in market, because liquidity scenario is quite buoyant. So it is quite possible that we may not see any meaningful correction, but a time correction, and still these levels would be good level to invest in?
Oh, absolutely right. And I think you have brought in up a very important point. A major reason why we have not seen the markets correct despite disappointment on earnings has been that the liquidity has been pretty abundant, whether with retail investors or the same retail investors investing through mutual funds. Now, the good thing is that over the next 5 to 6 months, we have extremely good IPOs lined up, which essentially means very new companies which have hitherto not been available to investors being available, and which will suck out a large part of this liquidity. So essentially what it would mean is that instead of the same money chasing the same old stocks which people find good today, would get diverted. And therefore, the sense is we may not see a large price correction, but yes, a time correction can very well happen, and I would agree with you on that aspect.
Amit, I'm seeing that banks and financial constitute more than 30% of the weightage, and I won't dwell into it because that's how market have positioned themselves. But where is IT, where is telecom? Don't you think so there is a value proposition there now, or you would still hold on to your horses and then take a call maybe when clarity emerges?
So good that you highlighted these things, the key overweights and underweights for our portfolios. Now, the main reason for us to hold any sector or company or not to hold it essentially emanates from the visibility that the business has in the years to come, and also how the past of that sector has been, or the company has been. Now, the two sectors which you highlighted, IT and telecom, which we have not owned for quite some time. Telecom, we have not owned for the last 3 years. IT services space, especially, we have not held in a meaningful way, again, over the last 3 years. Primarily, the reason being, that in the IT industry, we have seen a significant slowdown in the growth of these companies. So if these companies are growing at, let's say, a top line of about 7-8% and a similar bottom line, then they do not excite us, given the fact that we have other opportunities where companies are growing at 15-20%, and they are the ones which will help us compound our wealth in.
Now, there, apart from, you know, the big name which I won't comment on, are you still bullish on OMCs, which have seen, you know, wonderful rally in last 1 year or so, but are now showing signs of, you know, exhaustion?
So the oil marketing business, if you see, and we have been closely watching this space over the more than a decade now. Till about 3-4 years ago, before which the entire pricing mechanism for these companies was regulated, the companies were never allowed to make economic profits. Now, if you notice, over the last 2-3 years, once the companies have been allowed to recover everything in terms of their cost for bulk of their products, there are still few products which where they have to bear some amount of subsidy. These companies have now for the first time started reporting profits which can be at least estimated by analysts, which say 5 years ago, it was very difficult for any analyst on the street or any fund manager on the street to precisely estimate how the earnings would be. Now, what we have seen till now has been a re-rating in terms of the valuation for these businesses, because now we are looking at a company which is fairly in terms of ascertaining their earnings. And now, incrementally, what we will see is the business growth. So if you see the volumes of retail petroleum products, that has been growing at a very healthy clip of high single digits. And why not own a business where the business, as I said, is growing at a high single digit? You have pricing power today. On a daily basis, you are changing the prices of the commodity and you are maintaining your profitability margin. So I think going ahead, we have the CAGR of the business to accrue to you. And in case the market as a whole re-rates from these levels also, you have a chance of further re-rating in these companies as well.
Thanks, Amit. I hope that growth of OMCs are not coming at the cost of taxpayers, because petroleum prices are still at those levels, you know, which were when Brent crude was trading at $100 per barrel. But thank you for sharing your opinion.
No, no, in fact,
and good to hear from you.
No, actually. Let me just highlight one thing here. So yeah, what used to happen, the earlier subsidy burden was actually from our taxpayers' money. We don't understand that, but one should appreciate that. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Amit. Thanks for clarifying that.
Okay, so that was our conversation with Amit.